Thank you all for being here. So I want to talk about some joint work with Dave de Laat, especially some definite program solve for some scratch problems. So first I want to give on some an example where these some sort of scratch problems come up, and you all know it since it's came up in last week's lecture also. So the kissing number, we have a centrifugal unit sphere, and we ask how many unit spheres can touch that centrifugal unit sphere simultaneously. Well, Delsarte give a linear programming bound for that. So what's the bound? We have a polynomial expressed in its Gegenbauer expansion with some properties, namely that the coefficients are non-negative. The coefficient at the first coefficient is positive, and the polynomial itself is non-positive on the interval which are allowed inner products of 2 points on the sphere. So then the bound is given by the bound on the kissing number is given by the function value at 1 divided by the first coefficient. So if we now scale this all such that the first coefficient equals to 1, then the bound doesn't change, but it gets a little bit easier to work with. And well, we can't use a normalization such that these polynomials are 1 at 1, at t equals 1. Well, then we want actually a good bound. So what we can do is we can make these coefficients the optimization variables, and then ask what's the best function such that what's a good function such that this bound is as good as possible. Now if we formulate this like this, so we have the objective function value, which is the polynomial at 1. Remember that we choose the polynomials such that they are equal to 1 at 1. And we have some the constraint that well, the polynomial is non-positive, so the polynomial minus the first coefficient is less or equal than 1 at some interval. Well, in this kind of constraints, that those come up very clearly in discrete geometry. So some examples of that are the kissing number for the Delsarte bound, but also the 3-point bound of Bashok and Valentin. But you can also formulate a sphere packing bound of Cohen and Elkies in terms of polynomials, and binary sphere packing bound, and also more general energy minimization bounds. So what these problems have in common is that if you increase the degree of the polynomials used, so the d in this expression, then the bounds get better. In some cases much better, in other cases just a little bit better. So what we now want to do is optimize over such constraints. So when is a polynomial non-positive or non-negative? It's exactly when it's a sum of squares in one variable at least. But if you now have a domain, then you can express it in two sum of squares. So with x on the positive real line of non-negative real line, then you can just get a weight of x. And if you have a interval as domain, you get just a different weight. And in general, so also for multivariate polynomials, you can do something similar. And that's due to Poutinard's theorem. So if you have a polynomial which is positive on some semi-algebraic set, so a set defined by polynomials, and if you have some algebraic certificate for the compactness of this set, then we can write this polynomial as sum of squares plus some weighted sum of squares, and the weights are equal to the polynomial used to define the semi-automatic set. So what we can do this with this, we can express a polynomial inequality in terms of sums of squares. And then if we increase the degree of the polynomials, we can arbitrarily do it to approximate the polynomials, polynomial constraint. But for this, we still need to characterize a sum of squares. So if we have a sum of squares, we can write this polynomial in terms of the coefficients with respect to a basis. And if we do that, so here we have a vector of basis polynomials, and these are the coefficients with respect to that basis. And we can take the basis outside of the sum, and we have here just a matrix. And in fact, it's a positive semi-definite matrix. So we can also express this in terms of an inner product. And then we have just an inner product with a positive semi-definite matrix. So if we optimize over sums of squares, we actually can optimize over positive semi-definite matrices. So what we then want to do is formulate our constraints, polynomial constraints, in terms of a semi-definite program, because in semi-definite programming we use positive semi-definite matrices as variables. So how does such a semi-definite program look like? Well, we maximize or minimize some linear functional dependent on the positive semi-definite variables and some free variables possibly. And we have some constraints, affine constraints, which also depends on the positive semi-definite variables and possibly some free variables. Well, so the question is, how do we formulate such a polynomial constraint in terms of semi-definite constraints? And there are basically two methods for that, coefficient matching and sampling. So to explain coefficient matching, suppose we have some basis of polynomials. And well, then we can express both sides of the equation in terms of this basis. So here we express the polynomial P as coefficients with respect to a basis. And here we have the matrix Bx, Bx transpose. So this matrix, we express it with respect to the basis, and then we still have an inner product with the variables Q. And since this is a basis, this equality, polynomial equality holds if and only if the coefficients are equal. So then we get these positive, this semi-definite constraints. So secondly, we have the sampling method. So if you have a set of points, we call that set of points unisolvent for the polynomials up to degree d. If the only polynomial which vanishes on that set is the zero polynomial. So what does that mean? If you add a polynomial, then it certainly changes the values on the points of S. In other words, two polynomials are equal if and only if they are equal on the set of on S, on the set of points. And we can use this to express our constraints as the evaluations of these matrix polynomial matrix and the evaluations of a polynomial P. And one nice property of this is that this is a rank 1 matrix. And we can use that to do some computations faster. In the, if you have just coefficient matching, you have you can choose your basis such that this matrix is sparse. So that's also a nice property. But we found that sampling can give a better speedup. So in fact, sampling can also be seen as a kind of coefficient matching. Because you have the Lagrange basis, which is the basis of polynomials such that on one of these points, the polynomial equals 1, and on the other points, it equals 0. So if you take all these polynomials, you also have a basis, and well, the coefficients with respect to that basis are exactly the evaluations of the polynomials. So that's the correspondence between sampling and coefficient matching. So what I just explained was already known, but what did we do? Well, we implemented a solver which has several properties. First of all, it's a primal dual solver. So for semi-definite programming, you have basically three types of solvers. You have primal solvers, dual solvers, and primal dual solvers. And primal dual solvers are more stable than just primal or just dual solvers. And additionally, you get, if you have for both a feasible solution, so you get a bound on how optimal your solutions are. I'll say a little bit more about it later. Secondly, we use height precision. So in discrete geometry, the problems are usually inherently ill-conditioned. So that's why we need a stable solver, and we also need high precision to be able to solve this for high degrees of polynomials. Like I said before, taking a higher degree polynomial usually improves the bound. So that's why we need high precision to get a good bound. And we also use parallel computations, which is of course very useful in this time where even a normal laptop has 4 cores and fast computers go up to, well, 16 cores for a normal computer. And there are clusters of computers which can have even more parallel abilities. We also use the low rank structure of which, for example, comes up in the sums of squares problems. And we also use clusters, and I'll explain a bit more about that later. So what you see here is that there are already quite some solvers which use one or more of these properties, but this solver is the first which combines them all in a very general way. So the this solver can actually be seen as a generalization of SPP, but SPP has a very limited structure it can use. So per constraint, you can use only 2 semi-definite variables, and you can only use rank 1 structures. And if you use multivariate polynomials, then that is usually not enough. So besides just implementing the solver, we also did some other things. So first of all, we combined sampling and symmetry. Sampling is currently mostly used in interpolation and approximation theory. Although Lufberg and Parillo already saw that it can give this nice lowering structure in some subscribed problems. But it was not yet combined with symmetry, and we wanted to solve the 3-point bound of Bashok and Valentin, and the best way to program that is with symmetry, with using symmetry. So for that we needed to know how that works with sampling. And what we also did is look into how to find a good basis and good samples. So the quality of the basis, especially the basis but also a bit of the samples, can have great implications of the ability of the solver to solve the problem. So a good measure for finding a good basis is actually how orthogonal it is with respect to some measure. And since we use sampling, a good measure is the discrete measure on the samples. So we use this all in some numerical experiments, and I will show you the results of that later. And the last thing I want to say a bit about is that we also looked into polynomial matrix programs. So what is that? Instead of polynomial inequality, you have a matrix with polynomials as entries, and you require that to be positive semi-definite on some domain. So you can see it as a generalization of polynomial inequalities. And in fact, there's a theorem which generalizes Putinar's theorem for this kind of polynomial matrices. And we also allow for structures with which you can implement this kind of polynomial matrix programs. I'll also say about a little bit more about that in a few minutes. But first, I want to go a bit more into the solver and how we exploit this structures. I see someone raised his hand. So
yeah, excuse me. I'm really not from your field, but I have a question. So just to understand, is each sample that you obtain, does it give a lower bound for this for the quantity that you want to compute, or is it an average over samples that gives you a bound?
The samples allow us to formulate these polynomial matrix programs in terms of a semi-definite program. So if you have all these constraints, so all these kind of constraints, and you have a matrix Q which satisfies them, then you have a sum of squares which equals your polynomial P.
Yes.
And if for example P depends on some other variables, then you can optimize over these variables to get a polynomial P which is non-negative.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for the question. So let me explain a bit about the solver and the semi-definite programs and so on. So we use a slightly more specialized semi-definite program than is standard. We have a number of positive semi-definite variables and still a linear functional over which we optimize. But the constraints are clustered. So here we have each J corresponds to a cluster. And this is a factor of constraints, basically. So here we have also factors of inner products. And in each, if if you use a positive semi-left net variable in one of these clusters, you don't use it in other clusters. So this corresponds to the polynomial sums of squares part, where sums of squares is modeled by a positive semi-definite matrix, but that's only used in one of these polynomial constraints. So if you have multiple polynomial constraints, they give different clusters because you use different positive semi-definite matrices. Well, and in general, for a primal dual solver, you have a dual problem and a primal problem. So I don't want to say a lot about it, but these objective, if you have a feasible solution for one of these problems, then you get a bound on the objective function value of the other problem. And in a primal dual solver, you solve them both simultaneously. So we will use both the y variables for the dual problem and the x variables for the primal problem. In the solver, the most we use a Newton search direction. So for that, we basically need a second order derivative of equations. And for that, we need a kind of Hessian, and that's the entries of that are given by this. So we have the primal variables, the dual variables, and the coefficient matrices. Computing this matrix and taking a Gillespie decomposition from of it are the most computational expensive steps. So we focus on that in speeding up the solver. So first we have those clusters. And if you put these matrices in a block diagonal matrix, with each cluster corresponding to one of the blocks, and you see that the coefficient matrices corresponding to one constraint in one cluster is only non-zero inside the blocks of that cluster. So if you have two constraints of different clusters, then this product is non-zero only in the blocks corresponding to the first cluster. But if we then multiply with a matrix which is only non-zero in the blocks corresponding to the second cluster, this gets zero, becomes zero. So that means that our matrix becomes also block diagonal, with blocks corresponding to the cluster. So if you then want to do a Gillespie decomposition, we can do that blockwise, so that's faster. And secondly, we had this lower rank structure of the matrices. So let me give the smallest example possible. We have just a vector-vector transpose as matrix. And because this is a trace inner product, we can cycle one of these vectors to the other side. And then we have just matrix vector products. And that's, of course, much faster than than these matrix products. The time complexity for computing a matrix product is cubic, whereas matrix vector products are given in quadratic time. But this is, of course, not the most general structure we use. But this is where it comes down to. I want to explain a little bit about the structure we use to show what you can do with it and how general it is. So a pair cluster, we have these matrices, and I'll show you from the right to the left where the parts correspond to. So in each cluster, we this term corresponds to being able to use several matrices. So you have your matrix, and this gives a block diagonal structure. And each of these blocks can have different sizes, and they correspond to different matrix variables. The second part is inside these blocks, you have also a structure, a block structure, but this is a different, this is not block diagonal, but just all blocks. So we have a number of blocks and they are all equal size. And each of these blocks can have a lowering structure. So lowering structure. What's important here is that the off-diagonal blocks don't have to be symmetric. As long as the full matrix is symmetric. So these blocks, they correspond to the, well, if you have polynomial matrix programs, like I said before, you have a polynomial with some, you have a matrix with some polynomials as entries, and each of these entries of the polynomial matrix correspond to one of these blocks, can correspond to one of these blocks of the matrix. So that's where you can use them. And well, that's that. And I want to go to the examples. So we did computations on the 3-point bound for the Kissing number of Bashok and Valentin. And the most important properties of that problem are that it has a multivariate constraint. So that means that if you increase the degree of the used polynomials, then the size of the problem increases a lot faster. And this time, in this case, it's a three-variate constraint. So the size of the problem increases by d to the power 3. And another nice property of this problem is that it's symmetric in the three variables of that constraint. And this gives actually a low rank structure instead of just a rank one structure which we saw before for the sums of squares part. And thirdly, there have already been quite some computations done by Ashok and Valentin themselves, but also a few years ago only by Machado and Oliveira. They went up to degree 16, and I'll show you in a minute up to where we went. So the second problem I want to show you some results about is binary sphere packing problem. De Laat, Oliveira and Valentin introduced a 2-point bound for this, which is actually a generalization of the Cohn-Elkies sphere packing bound. And this fits exactly in the framework of the polynomial matrix problems, which I mentioned before. And well, the second property of this problem is that it's numerically quite difficult. De Laat, Oliveira and Valentin could only go up to dimension 5 before there were too many sizes of spheres for which the solver could not give a good solution. And well, the combination of these properties gives good showcase of our solver, what it and our method, what it can do, and how stable and fast it is. So first, the 3-point bound. Here you see a plot of the time versus the degree of the polynomials. This, we compared our solver with SPA GMP, which is also the solver Oliveira and Machado used. And we computed just bounds up to 13, but if you would go up to 16, if you extrapolate, it gives about a factor 20 that our solver is faster than SPA GMP with normal coefficient matching. And we could actually go up to degree 20 instead of 16. And the computation time for that is a little bit more than 1 day, including modeling the problem. And this, to summarize, we have so 20 times faster computation for precious bounds, computations up to degree 20, and this gives also new guessing number bounds in some dimensions, which is of course also nice. So the second problem we used was brand new sphere packing. So this plot is the bound versus the ratio of the smaller and the larger sphere. And the bound on the density. So previously, this bound was computed up to the ratio 0.2. And in the case dimension equals to 2, there was the best known bound is the Florian's bound, which is a geometric bound. And for the computation previously done, they could not improve on Florian's bound, but if you go to a lower ratio, then we can improve on Florian's bound. Another interesting thing is that Florian's bound goes to 1 if the ratio goes to 0, but the optimal limiting density is actually a bit below 1. So the question is, where does this bound, this 2-point bound for binary sphere packing, go to? Does it go to the optimal bound, to somewhere in between, or maybe, well, we don't know, of course. There's not enough information yet to extrapolate or solve it. But this kind of thing is also seen in other dimensions. We also did computation for dimension 24, which is also a quite interesting dimension because the Cohn-Elkies bound is sharp in this dimension. So here we have again the bound versus the ratio. And for equal size spheres, this bound is exactly equal to the Cohn-Elkies bound. So we know that the Cohn-Elkies bound is sharp in this dimension. It gives the density of the Leech lattice. And if you follow this line, it looks like it goes to some value here. So the question is, what is that value? Well, if you look at the optimal limiting density, so if you let the ratio go to 0, what's the optimal density? Well, you can prove that it's equal to the density given by, if you have a larger poles of, if you put them in the optimal sphere packing And then put again the optimal sphere packing for with the smaller balls in the room in between. So here you have again an optimal packing. That goes to the optimal limiting density. So what's the density this gives? Well, for the larger spheres, you have a density delta, which is optimal density for one sphere, size of spheres. And you have some space in between, which is one minus delta. And of that space in between, you only use delta of a fraction of delta of that space. So this is you can prove that this is the optimal limiting density, and you actually see that the bound, well, it seems like it also goes to that bound, to that optimal limiting density. Of course, this is no proof, we know that, but it gives a good suggestion of what kind of things what kind of functions might be usable to prove this. Because in this case, there's a proof by Cornell and some others, I don't know the names, but with modular forms. So maybe you can use those functions to give also a proof that this bound goes to the optimal limiting density. And in fact, you see something similar in dimension 23. This is again the bound at the Cohn-Elkisch bound, and here you have the bound plus one minus the bound times the bound. So if this was optimal, then this would be the optimal limiting density, but this is not believed to be optimal. But it looks like it still goes to about the same type of bound. And that was all I wanted to say. So thank you for listening.